And what is the heart of it? What is it all about? Well, this book, again, is supposed to lay the foundation for our understanding of that principle. And maybe in our study of the book, we haven't followed as closely as we ought. Now, that would be one of the threads that just weaves itself through the whole book as we keep coming back to the promises that have been made. And we won't take the time, obviously, in this setting to review all of that. But we'll read. Let's read just a couple of verses that just illustrate the point. And I think a good way to do that, a classic illustration at least, could be found in 3 Nephi chapter 20. We'll get Christ himself to say it for us. And Mike, we'll let you read, and you can say whatever comes to your mind on the matter. But to start with verse 25 and in chapter 20 there, and read 25, 26, 27.
And behold, ye are the children of the prophets, and ye are of the house of Israel, and ye are of the covenant which the Father made with your fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. The Father having raised me up unto you first, and sent me to bless you, and turning away every one of you from his iniquities, and this because ye are the children of the covenant. And after that ye were blessed, then fulfilleth the Father the covenant which he made with Abraham, saying, in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed, unto the pouring out of the Holy Ghost through me upon the Gentiles, which blessing upon the Gentiles shall make them mighty above all unto the scattering of my people, O house of Israel.
All right, now summarize for us what you're getting out of that.
Well, there's an emphasis over and over again that the appearance of Christ of this people and the redemption of their sins comes about because of the covenants that had been made with their fathers.
Yeah, that's
interesting. They are part of the family of Abraham.
All right, and because you're the family, you get some of the blessings of being in that family.
I like what he says in verse 26, where there you get a feeling, something along the lines of what President Packer described a few years ago as to the power of the covenant to retrieve wandering sheep. Notice the language. He sent me to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities, and this because you're the children of the covenant. There's a power in the covenant to draw the people of the covenant back into the covenant.
Yeah. It's interesting. One of you got a Bible handy?
Your feet.
Peter's discourse on the day of Pentecost, when he talks to the assembled nations of Israel in the second chapter. If you got that, Mike, go down to where he starts, men and brethren, what shall we do, kind of thing.
In 2:37, 38.
Yeah, but
there it is.
All right. Now read what he tells them that they should do.
Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children.
Now note that. Who's the promise to? You and your
children.
Then what does he say?
And to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call.
Now there's a promise that was made to some fathers about their children down through the generations. Maybe the reason, one of the reasons that we really haven't caught this doctrine is because we've been too young. You don't start to worry about this till you become a parent. And then after you get as old as we are, you come to realize that the greatest blessing that you could possibly have would be the promise that your children would behave. All right? That they would do the kind of things that they ought to do. And this is part of the covenant and promise that we're getting. That's when you realize it doesn't matter what accomplishments you have. If you don't have those family bonds and ties, you don't have that which is most meaningful.
See, I think it's very heartwarming and hopeful to read again where we've just been from the Savior himself in 3 Nephi, that he doesn't leave us alone just saying, I gave you the promise, or I gave you hope that way, but that he takes in a personal role in helping that make that happen.
He intervenes.
Yes.
He intervenes. But see, when you start to get the vision of this, the very appearance of Moroni is an evidence of this. See, the fact that an angel would come back from the other side of the veil to bring a message to his posterity says, hey, the people over there are worried about their children, and they have something to say to their children. Now, people come with that kind of perspective, if they come with a message, you want to listen. It's obviously pretty important. So it isn't any surprise to us that in the Doctrine and Covenants, these revelations, as the whole story of the restoration unfolds, have again, this is the theme that weaves all the way through and binds it all together. And we get this as early as 1831. Now, I have reference to what the prophet learned in section 132, which seems a little out of place because that's at the end of the Doctrine and Covenants and wasn't recorded until 1843, but we know that the revelation was given to the prophet as early as the summer of 31. Now, Camille, why don't you read for us? Let's just, you just read three or four verses, starting with verse 28.
This is in section 132.
132.
I am the Lord thy God, and will give unto thee the law of my holy priesthood.
As ooh, what an interesting line. The law of my holy priesthood.
As was ordained by me and my father before the world was. Abraham received all things, whatsoever he received, by revelation and commandment, by my word, saith the Lord, and hath entered into his exaltation, and sitteth upon his throne. Abraham received promises concerning his seed and of the fruit of his loins, from whose loins ye are, namely my servant Joseph, which were to continue so long as they were in the world. And as touching Abraham and his seed, out of the world they should continue. Both in the world and out of the world should they continue, as innumerable as the stars. Or if you were to count the sand upon the seashore, you could not number them. This promise is yours also, because ye are of Abraham. And the promise was made unto Abraham, and by this law is the continuation of the works of my father, wherein he glorified himself.
Yep. That's really just a wonderful capsule statement of the whole plan of salvation. Mm-hmm. Now, Abraham?
It occurs to me that you would have had people talking in the 19th century about these kinds of things. That is, the people in America considered it to be a chosen land. Yeah. They saw themselves as modern Israel. But what had happened by this time in the 19th century is they had metaphorized it away. To them, it was to become a Christian was to become modern Israel.
That's right. And so America can be the fulfillment of
and
that.
We are the fulfillment. Yeah. And so people talked about these things, but along comes prophets like Moroni and revelations through Joseph Smith, and you begin to have Joseph sensing, this is not just metaphor. Yeah. This is literal.
Yeah.
This is literal stuff. You are of Abraham. You're not just symbolic of ancient Israel. You are modern Israel.
You are. Namely, my servant Joseph. So the member of the church, as they read that, they can just take out the name Joseph and insert their own name there, you see. And again, this is a promise that sticks, whether in the world or
out.
Death doesn't dissolve this. So you die without the realization of the promise. Doesn't matter to God, and no matter to him, you'll still receive that blessing. We're going to unite this family here or there, but we're going to unite it. We're about something that is really important. If the earth is going to fulfill its purpose, you see. And so we, in other revelations, almost in passing, we pick up references to this kind of thing. Come with me to section 86. This would bring us to December of 1832, and here, after this interesting an explanation of the parable of the wheat and the tares, which is really the story of the apostasy and the restoration and the authority that will be restored in the restoration, we then read in verse 8, therefore thus saith the Lord unto you, with whom the priesthood hath continued through the lineage of your fathers. Now, you see, Bob, we have the same kind of difficulty, not infrequently in our own gospel doctrine classes or priesthood classes where we talk about this, and people say, well, yeah, but these promises given to Abraham, they're just figurative. This is spiritual Israel.
Aren't we all adopted?
Yeah.